What is up, my ducks and drakes? Welcome to the Crater Lake. Today, we are reading chapters 11 and 12 of Tomorrow, a standardized fanfic by Bekka911. If you'd like to support the author or the fic itself, you could do so in the links in the description. If you'd like to recommend a book for Wattpad Read Aloud, you could do so in the Google Form link in the description. It's labeled. It's fun. And with that, we'll go on to chapter 11. Patton had decided that his negative feelings had amassed in a living, writhing thing under his skin. He could feel it when he breathed, pressing against his ribcage and purring in his veins. It burned when he moved, and when he dared to feel, it leapt into a frenzy and he spewed nothing but hurt. And so Patton vowed to feel absolutely nothing at all. He watched the world around him with a sort of disconnected curiosity, merely observing the events happening without ever really reacting. Was that how Logan felt? Just sort of hollow? Morning, Virgil, he greeted calmly, finishing up the pancakes. It was breakfast time, but there was no spark in the air. The atmosphere was flat and bland and hollow. Patton noted it down in his mind, and then breezed past the fact and simply continued going through the motions. What a wonderful thing, not feeling. Virgil said nothing, as Patton had suspected he would, and simply sat at the table next to a subdued Roman. "Where's Logan?" Roman asked dully, pressing his leg against Virgil's in an imitation of comfort. Patton frowned. "I'll go find him," he decided. "You two start eating. You have to get your energy for today." He set the plate of food down on the table, leaning close enough to Virgil to hear muttered, "You're not my Patton." That angry thing under Patton's skin lurched and scrabbled through Patton's blood, and for a moment he feared it would burst out of him in an explosion of angry and ouch and jagged and ugly. Gritting his teeth, Patton grabbed for the monstrous thing and tugged, forcing it back to sleep. He wouldn't be fighting that mess today. Mechanically, he stepped away from the table and resisted the urge to tell Virgil that his Patton was broken and ugly and gone. Instead, he smiled and vanished with a soft pop. Virgil crinkled his nose at the sharp smell of sour citrus. Patton didn't appear directly in Logan's room. He wasn't sure why he'd decided against the move, but he went with it anyway. Too apathetic to really think about it and care. Logan was probably too caught up in work, that was all. Patton had nothing to... "I'm alone, Deceit." Logan's voice was like steel, cold and sharp and hard. He was angry. Logan's anger had always burned cold. "Your pushing has caused monumental changes within the group dynamic. We have a serious situation on our hands."
"Logan,"
Deceit soothed.
"Everything is fine. Patton is just dealing with his issues. Isn't that you all lot all? Isn't that what you lot all love to do? Work through your issues independently while being extremely angsty?"
There was a thud as if Logan had slammed his hand against something. Patton bit his lip and adjusted his position to try to hear better. "Patton is not a part of your games. Virgil and Roman are not a part of your games. I am not a part of your games. Stop meddling, Deceit. Nothing good will come of it."
"My job is to Thomas," Deceit hissed. "Not to you."
"How do you think Thomas will cope with the instantaneous constant emotional trauma, hmm?" There was a tinge of frosted cruelness to Logan's voice now, and Patton felt something sad sputter to life in his chest.
"Your meddling sets us off balance, yes, but we are the main aspects of Thomas's personality. How do you think our host will adapt to us being at odds? How well do you think he'll cope with the constant fighting and emotional outbursts and unbalanced emotions?" Does this care for Thomas, or concern for your lovely little Patton? It took Logan no time at all to answer, and Patton felt something near his heart splinter. My host is my priority. Patton's refusal to acknowledge his emotions grows tedious and repetitive. Patton backed away, already shaking his head. There was a dull roar in his ears, and the breathing, screaming thing under his skin was clawing wildly as waves after wave of devastation drowned Patton's senses. Tedious. Repetitive. Logan thought that. Logan hadn't learned from Virgil at all. Patton needed that blanket of icy calm. He needed the hollow silence and the numbness of not feeling. He needed to pretend that Logan hadn't said that he hadn't heard that. He needed to forget that he was broken, that he wasn't okay, that he needed something, that he had something wrong with him. He just needed to not feel. He'd be okay if he just could lock away his emotions. When he swept back into the kitchen, the cloak of calm was clutched around him tightly, and Patton didn't dare let his fingers hurt from holding on too tight. Logan didn't join them for breakfast. Patton let his pancakes go cold. Logan's anger had always burned cold. 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 Betrayal felt an awful lot like frostbite. Chapter 12. It was hard to look Logan in the eyes. Whenever the logical trait was present, Patton found himself avoiding contact, both physical and verbal. Trying to speak to his friend was like trying to talk with a ball of tissue stuck around his throat, and Patton just found himself straining his throat in silence while Logan looked on, unaware. Eventually, Patton just gave up and bustled around like he usually would, sans the talking. And maybe that was what his perfect little illusion crashing down around him, because if there was one thing Patton had never been, it was silent. "Patton," Roman said from the table, closing the notebook he was writing in and setting down his pen. For once, the royal wasn't buried in work. Thomas was having a lazy day. "Do you think you'd want to sit down with us? Perhaps we all need to talk." For a moment, Patton stared and weighed his options. There was an overwhelming urge to flee, pounding at his hollow, hollow bones, and he really, really didn't want to be there. But there was a larger part of him, the mature part of him, that recognized that they really did need to have a talk. A long talk. This time with no accusations and no yelling and no anger. Just talking. Except Patton saw that lump in his throat, and it was expanding rather rapidly. It held his words in his chest as he sat hesitantly, feeling trapped between Logan and Virgil. He'd never been scared of his friends before, but something about this intervention made fear crawl over his skin and defense aggression bubble in his hands. "Relax," a voice whispered in his ear, and Patton started. It wasn't Deceit's taunting hiss, no, it was an unfamiliar drawl. It sounded deceptively happy. "Everything's gonna be fine. You just gotta smile, yeah? Swallow your anger down," another unfamiliar voice added in his other ear, the sound gentle and soothing. "Getting angry will solve nothing. Neither will crying. Just push it all down and everything will be okay." These voices he should be scared of, and yet Patton found that he could only summon a sense of familiarity. He knew these voices, knew them like the back of his hand, and he knew that they weren't a threat to him. The only threat to him right now was his overwhelming emotions. That second voice, that one that was smooth like whiskey, was right. He just had to swallow them down. "Patton, I believe it's time you told us what you're feeling," Logan began, and Patton winced away. Logan's voice sounded all wrong, like jagged glass pieces grating against each other. It was sharp and harsh and wrong. Patton wanted his two new voices. They sounded like happiness and honey and soft. He looked down at his hands, trying to dissolve that stupid wad in his throat.
Let me... The first voice purred, and suddenly Patton's throat was free, and he could swallow and breathe easier than he'd ever been able to since... Well, since the beginning. I believe that everything's fine, he said to the three at the table, trying to force some brightness onto his face. Honestly, I've been working through my emotions, and I really think that I'm getting close to sorting everything out. Virgil snorted, shouting Patton an unimpressed look. Is that why you aren't sleeping? The younger side asked, harshly raising an eyebrow. Is that why you won't even look at Logan? Because to me, that doesn't sound like working through it. That sounds like denial and determination to completely ignore what's happening. I don't know what you're talking about, kiddo. I feel great. Patton. Roman's voice was quiet and less jarring, and Logan's had been. Enough. Please. Just tell us the truth, okay? And oh, how Patton wanted to, because he looked at Roman, at Logan, at Virgil, and Patton saw movie nights and onesies. Patton saw a mountain of pancakes and Roman's ridiculous sugary creations, and Logan's face whenever he allowed himself the luxury of crofters. Patton looked at his friends, and he saw everything he wanted, but when he opened his mouth, the wad of paper was back, and he just couldn't. Honestly... He said, his voice was just as quiet as Roman's had been. I think that we can't fix this one as a family unit. I think that this is just something I have to work through. Me, myself, and I. Devastation spread across Roman's face, and he leaned back in his seat, staring at Patton like he didn't recognize him. I thought you always said that we should share our problems, the royal said slowly, sounding dazed. And now you're keeping your own secrets? How are we supposed to trust you when you're saying, when you don't even... You? Virgil reached out and placed a shaky hand on Roman's arm. Roman, he said very, very softly, don't. Not now. I'm sorry, Patton said clearly, still not quite machining to look at Logan. The conversation he'd overheard was dancing through his thoughts, and he really just didn't want to. He just didn't want to. Look, I know I'm being hypocritical, but I really think that I'm dealing with this well enough on my own. Please don't be angry with me. Virgil met his gaze head on, and he seemed to find something on Patton's face. He nodded. We'll never be angry at you for feeling, he told the moral side. But keeping secrets from us, like the fact you've been hearing something we can't help but be hurt. And then, as a unit, the three of them stood up and backed away, and Patton was left sitting there, wondering why on earth he'd suddenly lost the ability to be a decent, honest person. You'll be okay tomorrow, those two foreign voices promised, speaking in tandem. You just have to hold on a little bit longer, and then everything will be just fine. And somehow, Patton found that he'd believe them. Thank you all so much for watching. If you would like to support more endeavors like this, I post Wattpad Read Alouds every Wednesday for you to keep up with the final book of this series. I absolutely love this series. It's my favorite, and so I enjoy reading it a lot. If you'd like to support me and my endeavors, my social media links are in the description below. That includes my Discord server, my Wattpad, Twitter, Instagram, and a TikTok where I do a whole bunch of Broadway stuff because I like Broadway. If you'd like to, once again, support the author, please use the links in the description below. There's also a link to my Etsy shop where I make cool beaded things. I do commissions. I could easily make Center Side stuff. I honestly just enjoy making Center Side stuff, if I'm being honest. And with that, thank you for watching once again. And much like Patton, trying to sit at the table without dying, I guess, do your best.